My name is Hannah Nicholson, and I'm an aspiring Southern Indiana beef producer.
So today I'm here with my friend Hannah Nicholson. This is her farm, homestead, whatever you'd like to call it. This is her, which one is this?
This is Maggie, this is my oldest dog.
So we have Maggie with us too, which, hello, who wouldn't want that? We have our coffee made, and I'm going to sit here and ask Hannah a few questions about her farm and just about her time as a student at Purdue. That's how we met. And we're just going to have a little conversation and sip on some coffee. First of all, what does it mean to you to be a young beef producer?
All my challenges are uphill. Everything's stacked against me at this point in time until I get an actual, recognition or any kind of background, people knowing who I am and what I do. So until I get an actual stable foundation and supporters, then...
But it's worth it, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Like, I got advice. All of the good times most definitely outweigh the bad. This is actually a family thing. I think I'm a fourth or fifth generation farmer. But my dad took a break. My dad's a construction worker. And so this was never his plan to raise cows again. You don't need coffee.
But I do. I'll take
but
it.
You do.
There we go. There we go.
So, yeah, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, so on and so forth. Everyone's raised cows.
Yeah.
Everyone has. My dad, he grew up that baby boomer, like, I don't want to do what my parents do.
That's, right.
Yeah, so my dad went off. He always loved the farm life. Don't get me wrong. He always wanted a farm. But I don't think raising cows was ever in his plan. So that was my plan. My mom likes to say all of the agriculture, passion, anything, it just skipped a generation.
We know that you raise Herefords.
We were half cross cows and half purebred.
Okay. Nice.
Trying to see what's going to pay us the most money.
But has it always been Herefords?
Generationally, yes, it's always been Herefords.
Okay.
My grandpa likes to tell the story of his dad.
Careful with the tripod.
My grandpa likes to tell the story of his grandpa was the first one to bring a Hereford bull over from... We're originally from Norway. So from Norway to what is now North Carolina.
Okay.
And then he walked the same Hereford bull from North Carolina to Corbin, Kentucky. That's where it all started with my great-grandpa, I believe. And then from Corbin, Kentucky to 10 minutes that way.
You've been here?
Since then, yeah.
In this area?
Ever since then, this has been the newest addition to any cattle operation.
Got it. But you also have some shorthorns, correct?
Yeah, so I showed in 4-H for my FFA advisor. Mm-hmm. I showed shorthorns and I eventually just bought them off of him because you get connected, so you just want to be there all the time. Mm-hmm. And so we bought them off of him and they've just been like some of the best cows we've had, which is funny because like my dad didn't want them.
Of course. We met at Purdue, which I've said. And you chose to study animal sciences.
Yes. That wasn't the original plan, but yes.
Okay. So let's talk about that a little bit, about how it's generational. You're really the one who's been carrying it on.
Yes.
But you chose that you wanted to leave to get an education.
Yeah.
So you're 2.5 hours away from home.
Yes. on a good day.
Yeah, right. Without traffic. I-65, man. Oh my gosh. So why? Why? Why was it so valuable to you to leave home to get an education rather than just staying here to help with the operation?
You know, just having the education of better practices for raising my cows.
Okay.
I mean, just because there's a ton of stuff I don't know, and there's stuff I'm going to be learning whenever I'm 50.
Right.
You know, I learn something new every day.
Yeah.
But having the education to kind of help back me up, it's like, so, like I said earlier, being a girl and a young person raising cows is absolutely ridiculously hard.
Yeah.
Way harder than what it should be.
Hopefully it'll get easier with time.
Yeah.
I think we're making strides to that.
See, everybody likes the fact that young people are coming back into beef production.
Right, because it's been an issue.
I actually had this thought of giving my resume and then putting a male's name on it.
Yeah, to see the difference.
And see the difference, because one of my male friends who does beef production, we've applied to almost all of the same internships.
Right. You guys have actually met this particular gentleman.
Well, I wasn't going to name
very great gentleman, very deserving of those positions.
Oh yeah.
But traditional male positions, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think a lot of it comes back to, it's a male's dominated industry without a doubt.
Yeah.
What I was saying about putting my resume, if I ever put my resume with some guy's name,
yeah,
I'd be more likely to get those internships. So we applied to the exact same internships. We actually applied to the exact same one last year.
Yeah.
And I never even got an email back saying that they accepted or they even recognized that they got my resume. Mm-hmm. And then they call him a week later.
Yeah.
And it's just...
And it's probably not an experience thing because...
No.
As far as education, I think the only difference there is he's been in a fraternity.
Yeah.
And you didn't do any sorority things at Purdue.
No.
Me neither. For our own reasons,
personal
right?
Personal choice.
So that's interesting. It would be an interesting experiment to kind of check that out to see... Is it still a stereotype that males are more selected for positions? Because those weren't just like office positions.
No, they were outside pulling calves, mending fence, stuff I do here every day.
Yeah.
Every day.
Right.
And so...
So you'd be just as qualified.
I'm just as qualified.
That's something our industry has struggled with.
Yeah.
To get over that hump of saying like women and minorities even... are just as capable of doing a lot of these on the farm jobs.
Yeah.
It's not, I mean, for me, it is different, I guess, because I didn't grow up in this atmosphere. So for me, I am looking for that office job, but I still want to get my hands dirty, right?
Right.
So.
Absolutely. Like, that's how they're learning.
This is. We've got a new one.
This is Sadie.
Wow. Hi. Welcome to the party. Basically, point is, the education helps you to bring back here. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
And speaking of education, let's talk about NCBA a little bit. I recently posted our travel diary to the National Cattlemen's Beef Association convention, which was this year in Louisiana, in New Orleans. So we had a good time there.
Yeah.
So obviously you have the foundation of education, but it's more than that too, right?
Right.
You say you're going to be learning at 50 years old. So, are there other organizations besides NCBA that you've gotten involved with?
So, going back to Purdue, joining the Purdue Collegiate Cattlemen's Association, having fellow young people who are interested in that sort of thing, and there's actually a girl about 30 minutes that way, so her family raises her birds too.
Oh, okay.
And so, we made that connection of, we almost bought replacement heifers off of her, and then something different came up, everything happens.
Yeah,
everyone wants to see young people come back into it and kind of take over generational family farms. They don't want family farms to go under like a lot of them have.
But I think like your point about people coming back for production specifically, because the ag industry is booming. Like, don't get that part wrong. Like, the ag industry is doing well. Obviously, everyone has to eat. Everyone needs to have transportation and fuel.
Right.
And clothes on their back, which a lot of that is agriculture-based. Yep. We know that. But so many young people don't want to work on the farm. They want to work in the companies. They want to sell the products.
Yeah.
They, like me, they want to design the logos or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's kind of been hard to find that mix of being a young professional, but also being a young producer.
Yeah.
And I think that's something you're striving toward.
When you 2.5 hours away, the process is extremely slow.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, sure, I can call my dad and we can talk for 2 hours and we can kind of hash some stuff out, but unless we're together all in the same room, nothing gets done.
Yeah.
So that's why coming home on break, spring break, Christmas, etc., that's when the most stuff gets done. It's terrible.
So it's hard, I imagine, to be in this kind of position to have to be away from home get the education that you value, but to still be trying to progress
keep
your operation
going. My dad does everything here. So basically what that includes is just head counting, our fences up, is everyone where they should be? Is everyone fed? Do we have hay out? Are the water tanks filled? Because we don't have automatic water, that's more of a task. That's a chore. Whenever I'm physically here, I just kind of help my dad make it a little bit less taxing on him. So even right now, when my parents ask me, what do you want to do? Because, I have this 4-year degree. I've got I've got a lot behind me.
Yeah.
I could do a lot of great things. But I tell them, I just want to be here. I just want to raise cows. It's finally become real that down here in southern Indiana, there's not that many people who have the same idea. Sure, you can raise cows, but you're not going to make that much money off of it. And even like right now, like cattle definitely have the slowest rate of return.
But that's because it takes 2 years.
Yeah,
for one cow to be sold, really, because you have to go through gestation and all of it.
Yeah,
there's a lot. It's a lot of work.
It's a long, long process.
Yeah, and there's a lot of details, and there's a lot.
Yeah,
basically.
There's a lot of inputs for a lot of output. So are you gonna get a job and blah blah blah?
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, I kind of have to. I gotta fund the dream.
Yeah.
My dream is this.
But it can't be full-time anymore.
I can't afford all this.
I would love to raise cattle someday. That is my long-term goal.
Yeah.
But when I start looking, like when we go to NCBA and I sit through these sessions and I start going and visiting operations like Hannah's, I see you have to buy chutes, you have to buy the vaccinations, you have to buy the cattle themselves, the feed, which is a constant input.
Never stops.
Water, which you have to deal with water, utility bills and things, the land, there's a lot. Mm-hmm. So when I get to talk to people, even my friend, it just puts it into perspective like how big of an investment it really is to have your own operation.
Absolutely.
But it's worth it. I mean, you have to go back to that. It is literally worth it.
It's incredibly worth it. Yeah. In the middle of calving season right now.
Okay.
And so my dad, he'll go take pictures of the cows, the cow-calf pair now, and he'll be, so hey, this one was born at this time, and it has this parents, and so add that to our sheet. Yeah. Its tag number is this.
Okay. So really, even when you're far, you're still doing some of that managerial work.
Yeah, I'm in charge of the farm roster. I always keep a printed out copy in here in the bulletin board in the office.
Yeah.
And as soon as it becomes outdated, my dad will go through and he'll like write in everything. He'll fill it out for me.
Until you can update it.
Until I can update it.
Yeah.
So it's definitely a joint.
For sure. You're not at the point that you can do it all yourself yet.
No, I mean,
we're almost there.
Getting there.
Both of us graduate in May. So from that point, it may change a little bit for you.
Yeah.
Because you'll be living back in southern Indiana.
Uh-huh.
So that'll be good.
Yeah.
That'll be good.
I'm excited.
Yeah.
It's definitely like, I've been out of the loop for so long.
Because you're just so in and out of it right
now.
Yeah. I mean, you're still here, but you aren't physically here, so like, it makes it a little different.
I'm present in spirit.
Yeah. So, since you'll be back, what, like, farm chore are you looking forward to doing again the most? Or is there one you really hate that you're, like, least favorite looking forward to doing?
I mean, because we're so small, we only have 23 right now.
Okay.
So, because it's so small scale, we do everything by hand, so there's not one that definitely outweighs the other. Pouring in feed, carrying out feed buckets, throw them in the troughs. Then, like I said, we don't have automatic water, so grab the garden hose, yank it 50 feet to our waterers.
Yeah.
Like, there's definitely not one that outweighs, give or take, the other.
So, the two biggest lots that we have right now, we use for our cow-calf kind of thing. It's where we keep the big cows. And so what this is you can actually see, like, the fence line runs all the way through and back here. And so we have the ability, like right there in the middle, there's a big opening, and that's where we can separate out this acreage for this one. But that gives us the ability to pasture rotate and build up this completely muddy lot right now, just because it's so much rain. But yeah, so being able to pasture rotate, you know, we can kind of build up other lots, and then we actually use the furthest lot over here, which is a lot smaller, but it's what we use for whenever we wean. And that's where all of our calves will go.
Okay.
And so the smaller guys, they don't really need as much space compared to the big ones.
Being a young woman in ag, kind of my pro tips is definitely support any young farmer, but definitely give the young female farmers a chance.
Yeah.
That's all we want, is to be heard. And luckily around here, my dad's been my biggest fan ever.
Right.
He's pretty well the only one that's like, yeah, let's do this. One of his friends is actually going to teach me how to AI. On our own herd. So that's a huge deal.
Oh, pause. So AI in the agriculture industry actually means artificial insemination.
Not
artificial intelligence, which has been kind of a funny thing that's been happening. So when we walked this morning, we got up slept in a little bit.
Yep.
Walked down to just look at the cows for a little bit second, and first thing I notice, I'm like, I miss the smell. And for people who aren't around this all the time,
it smells awful.
They don't. I'm like, oh, sorry. I apologize to Hannah. I'm like, sorry, that's weird. But I'm like, wait, you totally get that. Cow manure is like, okay, guys, let's just be real here, okay? So there are different like smells, aromas of manure. And oh, I gotta say, cattle manure, specifically beef cattle, I haven't been around enough dairy farms to know, but beef cattle manure aroma is pleasant. Like, it's not bad.
Of manure smells,
yeah,
it's the best.
When you compare it to like poultry and like swine.
Turkeys are the worst.
Chickens are weird too. Like, poultry.
Poultry in general is terrible.
In pigs, I just can't get behind that either.
Yeah.
Like, literally don't want to be behind it.
Like sheep.
The ruminants. That's why it's a ruminant thing. The way they digest probably makes it smell better. Which is okay, whatever. That's weird.
That's a topic for a whole other day.
Pro tip, if you wanna go like tour a farm, cattle are the way to go. Right. Thank you, Hannah.
Yeah.
That's not a toy.
Eli.
Go on. I told you your tail was dangerous.